Controversy. Humans as creatures are known for creating controversy around many elements in life. Video games are no strangers to controversy. Many video games throughout history have been paraded around as inducers of violence, including popular games like Call of Duty and even lesser known games. However, none reached such length in the public eye like the fighting franchise Mortal Kombat. In fact, Mortal Kombat was so controversial, it is the reason why we have ratings on every popular video game today. Welcome to The Arcade, a new show brought to you by the Nstlkia Channel. I'm your host Zainah, and in The Arcade we talk about all things video games. From the old, to the nostalgic, to the retro, video games have been a very definitive piece of human history and modern entertainment. In 1991, Mortal Kombat began its development with four people: Ed Boon, John Tobias, John Vogel, and Dan Forden. The first Mortal Kombat began as a ninja-themed project by John Tobias, who was still a new employee at publisher Midway Games. However, this idea was rejected by Midway's management. Instead, Midway wanted to create a video game starring Jean-Claude Van Damme, but the idea never came to light. Instead, they decided to create a sci-fi fantasy fighting game known as Mortal Kombat. They spoofed the Van Damme character by creating Johnny Cage, a very popular face of the franchise today. Midway had wanted to create an arcade fighting game after the success of Capcom's Street Fighter II: The World Warrior. However, Street Fighter II did not play a significant role in the development of Mortal Kombat. In fact, John Tobias stated that they wanted to make sure their game was very different compared to Street Fighter II, and that they had actually drawn most of their inspiration from a 1984 Japanese video game called Karate Champ. The name Mortal Kombat was created after the team had a difficult time trademarking Mortal Kombat with a C. Pinball designer Steve Ritchie then decided to replace the letter C with a K, and now it has become one of the defining features of the franchise, with purposely misspelled words in games. In October 1992, Midway Games released the first Mortal Kombat to arcades. Of course, there's something about Mortal Kombat that stood out to people instantly: the fatalities. Mortal Kombat drew elements of the 80s and 70s cinema, with over-the-top violence, inspiration from kung fu movies, and inspiration from action films. Of course, the infamous fatalities were the defining point of Mortal Kombat. A gratuitously gory finishing move that was just there because the developers could add it. In reality, it didn't add to the gameplay, but it helped define Mortal Kombat, and it helped to create a name that people would always remember. Mortal Kombat was extremely successful in arcades, and didn't need to reach console ports to earn such positive responses from teenagers in the United States. But, of course, the media and parents had to bring up the violence of Mortal Kombat. Many were calling on the home versions to be censored of this violence. Parents were outraged at the fact that their kids were playing such violent and bloody video games. Arcades attempted to censor Mortal Kombat but saw massive decreases in their profits, all but solidifying that people loved the violence and gritty dark gore of Mortal Kombat. Mortal Kombat would go on to be ported to home game systems by Sega, which was their Genesis, and then the Super Nintendo. The Genesis port allowed for a code to unlock the gory fatalities, but Nintendo attempted to make it more friendly to families by recoloring the blood gray and removing all the graphic fatalities. Then, the Genesis version came with a first-ever content rating. It was rated Mature 13 by Sega's Video Game Rating Council, and offered a warning to parents regarding the violence in Mortal Kombat. The launch of these home ports was so successful. On September 13, 1993, millions of copies were bought off of the shelves. It was a record-breaking moment for the video game world. In fact, Sega's Genesis had a much better time in comparison to Super Nintendo because of the violence being left in the Mortal Kombat Genesis version. Nobody cared about the other things. Mortal Kombat was bloody, and that was what the people wanted. The controversy had worked in Mortal Kombat's favor, and work began on a sequel almost immediately. Mortal Kombat 2 held its badge of controversy with honor and included parodies of their fatalities, including what they called babalities, which turned an enemy into a baby, and friendships, which allowed for acts of kindness instead of brutally murdering the character. And then fatalities became even more bizarre and wild. More characters were being added, more hype was being created, and everybody wanted a piece of the Mortal Kombat pie. It was what children across America wanted to go to an arcade for. There were more moves added, more combos, more difficult skills to learn. Mortal Kombat inspired many other arcade games like Time Killers, Survival Acts, and Guardians of the Hood to add more violence and blood and gore. So many games realized that the success of Mortal Kombat must have hinged on its controversial violence, so they too wanted to cash in on throwing gore into screens across arcades. When Mortal Kombat 2 launched on the home ports, they no longer included censorship as an option. Nintendo decided to just let Mortal Kombat 2 on its Super Nintendo with all its blood and gore after seeing the hit they took in comparison to Sega's Genesis. But we can't talk about Mortal Kombat without talking about the ESRB, so let's hold that thought and explain the world of video game ratings. In 1994, the Entertainment Software Rating Board, or ESRB, was established in the United States to service both America and Canada. The ESRB arose in response to the controversies of video games with excessive gore and sexual content. Before 1993, nobody cared to have ratings on video games the same way they did on things like movies. It wasn't an industry practice. People didn't really question it, and they just played the games.
As ABC's Bill Greenwood reports, there is a growing concern on Capitol Hill that parents who buy some of those games may not realize just how much violence they're getting.
However, Doom and Mortal Kombat's controversies allowed for the idea of rating video games to become widely acceptable. So, several video game developers and publishers, including Acclaim Entertainment, Electronic Arts, Nintendo, and Sega, formed the Interactive Digital Software Association. This group then developed the ESRB rating system that is now seen on video games today. The ratings included early childhood, kids to adults, which was then later renamed everyone in 1998, then there was teen, mature, and adult only. It was the first rating system to give brief explanations on what content was included in video games. You know, the same way as if you go to GameStop and the employee starts listing all the things in GTA 5 and you really just want to play it already. Yeah, that list. Parents wanted to protect the kids from certain types of content, so they felt the ratings were necessary. Now, in my personal eyes, I think the ratings can exaggerate sometimes, but hey, I play video games regularly, so I might be a bit biased. But back to Mortal Kombat now. Mortal Kombat 2 would be the first title to release with an ESRB rating, of course. It was one of the most popular titles in video gaming, and it has remained one of the most popular in the series to this day. In 1995, Mortal Kombat received an action film based off of the game. New Line Cinema released the PG-13 Mortal Kombat movie that premiered at the top of the box office charts, and grossed over $120 million internationally, which is insane considering its $24 million budget. Mortal Kombat 3 was not so lucky in comparison to its predecessors in terms of its popularity. The initial shock and controversy of the bloody franchise was beginning to wear off. Several fan favorites like Scorpion, Kitana, Melina, Baraka, and others were removed from the fighting roster. Mortal Kombat 3 did not receive the response that Midway Games had hoped for, so they created an updated version of Mortal Kombat 3 for arcades and consoles to try and alleviate the situation. It was called Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3. Still, it left out some fan favorites. However, it did please many previously disappointed fans. Then, Mortal Kombat Trilogy brought every character from the series into one massive game that many loved, and this was done right before Mortal Kombat 4 would begin its development.
The crushing pound of a mallet.
Nobody wanted the 2D digitized photos that the old games had, so Mortal Kombat 4 would be the first fully 3D installment in the franchise. Midway Games had previously released a 3D fighter game called War Gods, but that was not successful. Still, it provided Midway a chance to see what went wrong and what would work in Mortal Kombat 4. Still, Mortal Kombat 4 did not see the successes of its predecessors. Nobody really cared that much anymore about the fact that it was 3D because 3D games were common. Extreme gore and violence weren't that shocking anymore, photorealism was gone. There was something missing from this title that the previous titles had. Mortal Kombat 4 was also outdated gameplay-wise in comparison to its competitor Street Fighter. The Mortal Kombat Street Fighter rivalry was so large that it was compared to that of Pepsi Cola. Mortal Kombat also got another film around the same time, but reviews were so much worse for this title, and the film was significantly less popular monetarily. The decline of Mortal Kombat was beginning. Mortal Kombat got a change of name and style in 2002 with the release of Deadly Alliance, which featured several changes, including better controls and more interesting and cool fighting. Mortal Kombat had finally returned to the charts, and Deadly Alliance outsold Mortal Kombat 2. Midway Games then changed their name to NetherRealm Studios, which is the name that you see today. The ninth game in the franchise was a reboot titled Mortal Kombat and was first released in 2011. Then, Mortal Kombat X was released in 2015, or Mortal Kombat 10, however you want to say it, and finally, its most recent installment in 2019 titled Mortal Kombat 11. It released for the Nintendo Switch, PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and Windows PC, with the upgraded versions for the next-gen consoles like the Series X and PlayStation 5 releasing in 2020. Mortal Kombat 11 was the best-selling game in April of 2019 in North America. It was a chart-topper across the world. It was the fifth best-selling game overall in 2019. By 2021, Mortal Kombat 11 had sold 12 million copies worldwide. It was nominated for several awards and won two. But, of course, what is Mortal Kombat without a dabble of controversy? Mortal Kombat 11 was banned from Indonesia, China, Japan, and Ukraine. In Ukraine and Indonesia, it was banned due to Nazi and communist symbols, which were present on some character cosmetics. Mortal Kombat 11 also got some slack for lowering the sexualization of its female characters while providing many shirtless male characters. However, Ed Boon, one of the original creators, stated that he felt it was, quote, unrealistic to have female fighters dressed the way they were in previous titles, and that the 2011 reboot had gone too far in its sexualization. Mortal Kombat also received a McFarlane toy line of action figures, and in February 2019, it received a mobile game that has 50 million downloads on the Google Play Store. Mortal Kombat isn't just an average, everyday video game franchise. It's a long-lasting, widely successful, an insanely popular one that has defined the world of video games, video game ratings, and more today. Many parents still reel at the idea of their kids playing Mortal Kombat, while others feel that its over-the-top and gory fatalities are just way too much. Still, no matter what controversy Mortal Kombat faced, it is still an insanely popular franchise, and one that has redefined what it means to be a fighter game. Mortal Kombat was one of the most successful arcade games of all time, and is still a widely popular title in the video game world today. Thank you all for tuning in to the first episode of The Arcade. Stay tuned for episode 2, where we will be covering the rise and fall of Atari. Don't forget to like, leave a comment, and subscribe, and be sure to turn on notifications so you never miss another episode. This was The Arcade. Thank you all for watching.